As our finalists prepare themselves to sit down, I wanted to share with everyone that today's Great Debate Finals will be streamed live. And I have a gentleman right over here who's going to come up. And so that everybody in the audience can understand what are some guidelines that we allow for the best sound possible, so for those viewing and watching this live can hear the debaters up here. So please come on up here and share the guidelines.
Hi, as you know, this is going to be live stream, so what we're going to need you to do is please be quiet as you can. I know you're going to want to have small conversations to go on, but you cannot do that. We do have ushers here to make sure that the room is quiet, and they will ask you to be quiet, and if necessary, they will ask you to step out for a moment. Some other guidelines are please do not cross the blue tape. The first four rows in these front two seating arrangements are blocked off, and good luck to all the finalists. Thank you.
I just would like to take a moment and just thank all of our project administrators for all the great work that they did back in their home communities to prepare our leaders from your community to bring them here today. Let's give them a big round of applause. And I also want to recognize the work of the head coaches, the fellows that were here, the chaperones that came in, all the NHI support staff and NHI headquarters staff that came in to join us, our board of trustee members that are here with us in the audience, our alumni, and finally the great debaters. Let's give everybody a big round of applause. The order for this evening will be this. I will announce the extemp draw finalists to the stage, along with the director of the extemp draw room. We will recognize them. They will be dismissed. They will move over to Ida Green 112, where they will be given their question. They will have 30 minutes to prepare their speech, whether in the pro or con arguments. When they're finished, they will wait and come back in between debates. Then we will have our cross-examination finalists that will present first, followed by oratory. Then we will bring back up our extemp speakers. We will next move on to mock trial and then finish up with our Athenium participants. We will ask the project administrators to come down here to the bottom so they can still serve as the judges. But before we begin, because he has to head into Dallas a little bit later on, we want to take a moment to address the entire audience with regards to leadership. Ladies and gentlemen, please help me in welcoming the NHI president, Ernesto Nieto.
We just finished having a board of directors meeting, and we happened to have lunch with the representatives of Austin College, and I heard testimonies from people like Anita from San Antonio, and from Tino, and from Dallas, Trey Santos, Trey Martinez, and it caused me to reflect about why we're here. And I know that I'm going to have to be leaving in a minute because some board members are having to catch planes to get back to their respective homes. But I want you to know at the end of the day, whether you advanced or not, why are you here? Why are you here at this moment of your life, at this crossroad of your history and your development? You're here because to develop your voice. Voice is your identity of the future. Without a voice, there is no future. Voice represents the conveyance of your ideas. And without ideas, we have no pathways to tomorrow. Voice is your ability to envision tomorrow. to allow us to dream of what comes in the mañana of our futures and our journeys. Voice is also for those who cannot defend themselves and rely on you as their future leaders to represent their interests. And finally, voice is for those of you who are going to design tomorrow. So the great debate is about finding voice and about rehearsing voice and about allowing yourself to be who you're meant to be, and that is the leaders of people. You are here to be the leaders of the Latino community of tomorrow, and you have taken your first step in that journey, and you have found out that the stronger your voice, the more compelling you are, and the more believable you are. You have found out that without voice, you cannot be heard. You have found out that when you think you have voice, others have a greater voice. And I hope you take those lessons home with you. And as you help us join and develop this community of NHIers, that you join the board, the people who are here as alumni, in forming this community of NHIers. Because it's not the Latino community that we develop, it's the NHI community. You belong to that community. And it is your pathway, and it is your direction, and it is your promise that we work on. So that 30 years from now, as I was sitting there with the board this afternoon, I told them that Anita Fernandez was only 6 years old when we came to this campus. George Rodriguez was only 16 years old when we came to this campus, as was his wife. Nicole was 14 years old. Janicio, Dr. Janicio Guzman, was only 1 year old. Now he's on our board of directors. And Natalia Palmerini hadn't even been born, and now she serves on our board of directors. Voice makes all those things possible. And it's that message, whether you advance or not, actually, I care very little about it. It's whether you practice your voice that I care about. Did you realize your potential and your promise? That's what I care about. Are you going to let this moment flitter away? Are you going to make it worth your lifetime endeavor? Good luck to all of you. Let's applaud the generous and the achievements of those who are going to be before us. Let's congratulate them, but let us know that we're part of a much larger community called the National Hispanic Institute. You guys have a good one. Finalists, are you ready? Before we begin, I wanted to announce our final judges for this afternoon. If you could please stand up, your tournament director, who's been working behind the scenes to make sure that we have a well-run program, who is working with her team on all the tabulations and the bracketing, your first finalist judge, Sandy De La Tejera, your tournament director. Our second finalist judge has been instrumental in the planning of this program here, and I remember getting to meet him last year as he continues to roll out the red carpet. So when you see all those signs that are on the doors for debate rooms, it was put together by this gentleman here, who will also serve as a finalist judge, the representative from Austin College, Michael Davila. And finally, the third finalist judge, and the way finalists that this works is that they will all judge you independently, and they will get their scores together and average them out to determine
who the winner is. So we use a panel for our finalists. So your third finalist judge is the Vice President at the National Hispanic Institute, Ms. Nicole Sada. Now I'm going to ask that if you have cell phones, to turn off your cell phones, or at least put them on vibrate, so we can respect them up here on stage as they begin to deliberate or they're giving their presentations, and that we honor the gentleman's guidelines with regards to streaming so that those watching can hear our participants up here. Also, you know, you have your representatives for students up here representing your region, and it's nice to want to cheer for them after they finish their opening statement. I ask that you hold all applauses and noise until the end of competition. So sometimes in a debate, it may get a little heated, and we like to see that. Hold the noise down. Wait until the conclusion of the debate before we recognize their great work up here. So at this time, I'd like to begin our debates. So to the stage, I'm going to ask that the extemp draw director, Ava Kajay, please come up here to the stage. Let's give her a big round of applause. Now, Ava recognized she worked with all the extemp draw participants. She assigned the competitors on each side, assigned a pro and a con, read them the question, and then managed the time. She is going to immediately go afterwards to Ida Green 112 to allow the extemp draw participants to fill out or complete their 30-minute prep, and they'll come back in here and provide their presentation. Since we've already selected the pro and the con for extemp draw, the pro and extemp draw from El Paso, and please come to the stage, Mr. Andrew McCullen. Representing con, also from El Paso, Pierce Davis. At this time, extemp and extemp draw director, go down, grab your stuff, head back to Ida Green 112. We best wishes to you, ladies and gentlemen. Let's give them a big round of applause. Now moving on to extemporaneous speaking. We allowed them to prep beforehand. They've already determined who will be arguing the side of the affirmative and who will be arguing the side of the opposition. So when I call your name, please come up here to the stage. Affirmative, please sit on this side. Opposition, on this side. Representing the leader in the affirmative from El Paso, Baylor Watkins. On to opposition, representing the leader from Corpus Christi, Lucas Weddle. And representing the member in the opposition, Misoya Sarani. So again, as a reminder, once the debates begin, let's hold all applauses and noise until the end, until they complete. CrossX finalists, your tournament director will be the MC during the debate. She will allow you, give you the timing, what that's going to look like. She will now guide you throughout the debate. At the conclusion, they will be dismissed, and the other educational director, Christina Tussini, will come up here and announce the team, the finalists for oratory. So at this time, if you can allow the finalists to write down their scores, tournament director, I'm going to turn it over to you. I'm going to brief them really quickly before I exit. Thank you.
The topic for cross-examination is resolved that the work of the National Hispanic Institute be redefined to focus on the development of leaders for unified hemispheric Latino communities. Your time signals will be as follows.
3 minutes, 2 minutes, 1 minute, 30 seconds, 15, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 5 second grace.
Leader of the affirmative, you have 3 minutes for your opening statement. Time starts when you do.
Partner ready?
Ready.
Opponents ready? At the judge's discretion. We should neither resurrect nor attempt to recreate what no longer should become the central focus in a new, changing world of tomorrow. That is demanding other strategies, other direction. We need to let that ship sink and remain in its final resting place. It is because I agree with the wise words of Ernesto Nieto that I stand in firm affirmation of the resolution at hand that states, resolved, that the work of NHI be redefined to focus on the development of leaders for a united hemispheric Latino community. I'll start off the case by introducing our value, which is that of utilitarianism. Utilitarianism is the greatest good for the most amount of people. And our voting criterion and how we are going to achieve our value is that of postmodern expansion. And what that is the growth of a community triggered by a modern mindset. Our first contention is networking. We will be introducing the concept of communication and the importance of communication to these young leaders in NHI. Because we will explain how communication leads to connections. And connections lead to economic growth. So if you have several different Latino communities that are connecting with one another, the benefits are vast, whether it comes from economics, politics, or any power in how they can help each other. That can lead into our second contention, which is catering to the needs of the Latino community. It has been said that the American dream doesn't adequately serve the Latino community, whether it comes to healthcare, housing, and especially discrimination. So what we'll be focusing on is creating this hemispheric ideal, this idea of the United Hemispheric Latino community and how all of these communities can connect together. Because in the United States, with the constant cultural clashes that can happen, and not only in the United States, but anywhere in the Western Hemisphere, this global idea or this hemispheric idea can evade of that. That leads into our third contention, which is that of a global society. Interconnections create a global stage, a pedestal, if you will. If you have all of these different Latino communities communicating with each other, they can have a global stage where they can share ideas, where they can learn from problems that the other communities have. So to finish this up, I will create a scale for you all. Point A is domestic relations. That is where we are right now. Point C is globalization. It has been said that globalization is inevitable. We can't fight it, we are in it, we just need to hold on for the long ride. The only point B in the middle is a hemispheric ideal, a hemispheric identity. That is the only way that we will be able to reach point C of globalization that is inevitable. With that being said, it is for these reasons that I see no other ballot than that of the affirmation. I now stand open for cross-examination and further points of clarification. Thank you.
Member of the opposition, you have 2 minutes for your cross-examination.
Your value, utilitarianism, was for the greatest good for the most amount of people, correct?
Yes.
How do you know that the people you reach are, in fact, going to take advantage of this?
Well, what this is, it is an organization by choice, so not overpowering government, which requires the consent of the people being involved. So with that consent, they are giving out ideas of how they can make it better to achieve the goals.
Thank you. And the people that you reach, what about the people you're leaving behind by this expansion?
Well, the people that we will reach, they will have been taught what we are offering, because as I said, it is an organization by choice. So the people who have not, let's say, they don't agree with our ideas.
Okay,
they might not fully
you.
Understand what we are doing.
There is positive growth along with negative growth, correct?
Correct.
So how do you confirm? Do you have any evidence to prove that this growth will in fact be positive and not negative?
Well, we are 100% sure of the evidence that states that, as I said, the inevitability of globalization and expansion, and this is merely a step
okay.
to achieve that.
Thank you. And your first point was regarding networking.
Yes.
And the importance of connections. When you expand, isn't it very likely that you can spread yourself too thin?
Can you please restate your question?
As a person expands, or as a balloon expands, or as a water droplet falls from the sky onto the surface, isn't it true that it expands and each particle becomes thinner?
Well, as we are doing this, we're going to be focusing on the distribution of leaders. NHI is built on creating these leaders. So we're going to be introducing these fundamentals to all of these different communities where they will be creating their own leaders. We are empowering them to create
okay.
their own leaders
Thank
for the community.
You. And your second point was regarding catering to the needs of the Latino community. And you also mentioned that the American Dream does not properly cater to these needs, correct?
Correct.
What country are we in?
We're in the United States.
Of America? Yes?
Yes.
So you are talking bad about the country we're in.
Can you please restate your question?
Are you talking bad about the country that we are currently in?
Of course not.
No further questions.
Leader of the opposition, you have 2 minutes of prep time. Audience, please remain quiet for the live streaming.
No further time needed for preparation.
Leader of the opposition, you have 2 minutes for your opening statement. 3 minutes, excuse me.
Hello, my name is Lucas Weddle. And along with my partner, Zoya Serrani, we are here to negate the resolution that the work of the National Hispanic Institute should be redefined to focus on the development of leaders for unified hemispheric Latino communities. Again, my partner and I are here to negate that resolution. The supreme value we are trying to achieve is progress. Progress is the development, advancement, and improvement towards a goal. The criterion for which we hope to attain our supreme value is leadership skills. As Ernesto Nieto says in his book, Third Reality, we all approach life in the best way we know how. Expanding NHI would not be the best way to approach life. If anything, it could easily hurt the Institute. And I have 3 reasons why. Our first point, in reference to the affirmative's first point, is that networks can fail and even become negative. Any true network or connection can easily become rotten, like a rusted chain in a link. If one link is rusted, the entire chain is completely unusable. The weakest link is always the worst part of a group. So it does not make sense to follow that point. Our second point is that America is already catering to the needs of the Latino community. The American Dream is already doing that. If the affirmative believes that it doesn't work, my partner and I believe that we need to fix the American Dream in America and make sure our core is strong instead of spreading too thin to other countries. Which brings up my third point in reference to their third point, that even in a global society, NHI is strong in the U.S. It isn't intended to be a global society. If it is spread too thin, it could easily weaken. As my partner said, like a water drop falling from the sky, as it is strong. But once it hits the ground, once it starts spreading, it breaks apart into fragments and does not considered a water droplet, and it's fragmented into many different pieces that are easily not considered useful. The NHI is great where it is. Don't ask it to be something that it's not. NHI is great in America. It's strong and it creates great leaders. If we spread to other countries and redefine our focus, it will not work as well, and it will possibly even bring negative connotations to the National Hispanic Institute. Thank you.
Member of the affirmative, you have 2 minutes for your cross-examination.
You stated your value being progress and advancement, correct?
Yes, I did.
If you are not spreading hemispherically and enabling a hemispheric identity, how else will you be expanding?
The whole point is that we are not expanding and that we will achieve progress.
Thank you. So you do not want the Hispanic community and the National Hispanic Institute to expand, correct?
No, I do not. I believe that it is strongest.
You. Are you aware that in the past 10 years and since the institution was created, the National Hispanic Institute has been founded upon the basis of expansion?
I was not aware of that, but now I am.
Are you aware that the National Hispanic Institute has already spread to countries in Latin America?
I know it has spread, but I don't believe that.
But if it has already spread thus far, how can it not be for expansion?
Because leadership in America is, as said by your leader, it is not, the American Dream is not providing good leaders for the Latino community.
Thank you. So you agree that the American Dream is not providing good leaders for the American community and the Latino community, correct?
I believe that NHI fulfills the job of the American Dream, as you have stated.
All right. And you also stated that we should retain, that we should stay on a national basis, correct?
I have, yes.
So do you not want to aid the other countries and other communities inherent within the Latino community?
I believe that the NHI does a good job in America, but I don't believe that it will keep the same standards and
so
skills.
So you believe that the National Hispanic Institute should neglect communities outside of America?
I believe that if it can give the exact same leadership and skills as in America in as the same way, then it can, then it should, but I don't believe that the National Hispanic Institute
but
is ready for
without
that.
Without expansion, how will the National Hispanic Institute ever be ready for that?
Could you please restate the question?
Without expansion, how will the National Hispanic Institute ever be ready for such goals and such changes which you stated?
I don't believe that I made any statements regarding change to the National Hispanic Institute.
Time. Thank you. Member of the affirmative, you have 2 minutes to prepare. Audience, please keep quiet during those 2 minutes. Member of the affirmative, you have 2 minutes for your rebuttal.
Partner ready? Opponents ready? At the judge's discretion? Our opponent stated within their case their value being progress and advancement. However, they completely neglected that the National Hispanic Institute has always expanded. And when asked how they would make progress despite expansion, they did not have a clear answer. This clear answer means that they have no means by which to derive their end goal. Therefore, their value falls, their value being the entire basis by which to follow their case. Also, they completely denied that NHI was built upon expansion, and they wanted to stay completely at a national basis. However, they neglected to mention also that the National Hispanic Institute has already spread to countries in Latin America. Such a spread to countries in Latin America means that the National Hispanic Institute does uphold expansion, and that is one of its main principles. Therefore, their contention falls. They also stated their second contention being that the American dream does cater to the needs of the Latinos. However, within the third reality, Ernesto Nieto clearly states that the American dream is not fitted for Latinos. And this reason was why the National Hispanic Institute came about, so that Latinos in America could be better represented and could be made into leaders. Therefore, their contention falls. And also, they stated in the cross-examination they agreed with us about the American dream not being catered to and not fitting the needs of the Latinos. Therefore, their contention falls. Their third contention stated that we have no need to go global and that we have no need for expansion. However, the National Hispanic Institute has already begun to spread, and spreading is one of the principles by which it was founded upon. The National Hispanic Institute began in Texas, in one city in Texas, and it spread to the entire state of Texas and eventually to the entire country. And now it has many countries in Latin America as well. Therefore, expansion is one of its main principles. Thank you. Time. Member of the opposition, you have 3 minutes for your rebuttal and closing.
Todos aprovechamos la vida en la manera que mejor entendemos.
This quote from Ernesto Nieto's Third Reality says that we all approach life in the best way in which we know how. Expansion is not the answer. Expansion is not the best way to approach life. This is not the way to go about if we are looking for the best way. The affirmative tried to prove that result. The work of the National Hispanic Institute should be redefined to focus on the development of leaders for the unified hemispheric Latino community. Their value, utilitarianism, where the greatest good for the greatest amount of people, was not in fact true, since they are so focused on the hemisphere we are expanding to that they forget about the people at home. This makes the core falter. We can't have our core weaker. And their criterion, growth of community. As this community expands, problems will be brought to the center. And as the growth of the community, the internal networks will suffer. Which their first point was networking and the importance of connections, We countered this point by saying networks can be positive and negative. There's no way to control anything. Like a Christmas light, if one goes out, the rest follow. There's no way to control that one Christmas light, just like we can't control if these networks are positive or negative, or if we will succeed or fail. Their second point, catering to the needs of the Latino community, and that the American dream does not properly cater to these needs. If a citizen of this own country, of America, does not believe in the American dream, and does not believe that it caters to the needs of the Latino community, then why should we expand if we need to focus on where we are now? Their third point, the global society and interconnections. This is a fact. If we globalize, we will spread ourselves too thin. We will have far too many problems, and this is a problem. NHI should not be something in which it is not. We should not ask it to be something that it is not. Michael Jordan was an excellent basketball player, but we all know what happened when he switched to baseball. NHI should not have to worry about baseball. We should just focus on basketball. We should stay the National Hispanic Institute, not the International Hispanic Institute. We are the NHI, not the IHI. And also, like a balloon, if you put too much air into it, if you expand and expand, one day it will burst. We cannot expand anymore. We are a perfect balloon that must stay where we are. This is why you should side with the opposition.
Time.
Thank you.
Member of the affirmative, you have 1 minute for your rejoinder. Audience, please remain quiet.
Partner ready? Opponent ready?
Ready.
At the judge's discretion? Our opponent stated that the National Hispanic Institute was already perfect as it was. However, as we all know, we should never settle for something less. We should always continue to expand and continue to grow. The National Hispanic Institute shouldn't settle for having reached one goal. We should always continue to find new goals to reach and new places to go. Because of this, we think that the Latino community and the National Hispanic Institute is like a car. It is composed of different parts, such as certain regions and different communities, but all of these parts come together to drive the Latino community forward. They drive forward with one leader, one driver, and because they drive, their mileage is always increasing. It is expanding. We do not settle to stay in the parking lot. We always continue to grow. We reach new places. We do not settle in staying in one place because we are safe here. The National Hispanic Institute should always continue to grow and should always continue to expand. Because of this, we are in firm affirmation of the matter at hand. Thank you.
Texas Great Debate finalist for oratory. Will you go ahead and approach the stage? We have speaker one, Daniel Guerra from San Antonio.
Rocio Nairi Garza Gomez from the RGB. Congratulations to you. Just one second. Turn it over to our tournament director, Sandy De La Tejera. Thank you. Orators, please be seated. We're going to take a moment to finish tallying up these last ballots. Speaker one, you have 5 minutes to prepare to give your speech.
Hola, me llamo Daniel Guerra y soy un miembro orgulloso de la comunidad latina. Al final del siglo XVII, un líder religioso del pueblo de Taos, que se llamó Popé, organizó y dirigió una rebelión contra los españoles que ocuparon la zona conocida hoy como Nuevo México. Él unió fuerzas de más de 70 comunidades viviendo en lo que hoy es el suroeste de los Estados Unidos. El 10 de agosto de 1680, dos docenas de pueblos atacaron a colonizadores españoles al mismo tiempo. Habían matado a la mayoría de los europeos y empujaron el resto al paso. Los líderes indígenas renovaron su poder y crearon un gobierno que sobrevivió hasta que los españoles dominaron la región otra vez. A pesar de sus diferentes culturales y lingüísticas, las comunidades pueblos se reunieron para forzar a los invasores de tierras y ganaron. In today's society, we all belong to a community of some sort, whether it be religious, school-related, or within our respective neighborhoods. While we all find unity in the communities we belong to, we, as a community of Latinos, have not found the unity that we so desperately need. The Pueblo Indians found unity under a common enemy, the Spanish Empire, and came together to overthrow them in New Mexico. In the future, I know Latin Americans will too band together, forming a community for the betterment of Latinos everywhere. Following World War II, 28 nations came together to form what is called the European Union, which has fostered economic stability, interdependency, and unity among its member nations. The EU has also instituted policies, which includes unrestricted movement between nations, which have proved beneficial, making Europe an area of peace and unity. Now, all communities are based on a shared purpose, interest, or characteristic held in common. As Latinos, we are known widely as Spanish speakers and largely as adherents to the Christian faith tradition. We cherish many of the same values and share most of the same celebrations with each other. Latinos hold much in common, but we are not yet a unified community. So my question is, why don't we contradict that statement? Why don't we unite as one to show the world how strong we are as a unified community? Ernesto Nieto, founder of the National Hispanic Institute, said in the 12th chapter of his book, Third Reality, moving forward to craft a new public direction for our community has to be our most important priority. I believe that all Latinos should come together under what I call the Latino Decalogue. The Latino Decalogue is a set of rules derived from the values and principles of our community. These rules form a philosophy that will hold us juntos como hermanos y hermanas. Some of the central tenets of this philosophy are as follows. 1. Have respect for all cultures. 2. Be honest to oneself and to others. And 3. Judge people on their character rather than how they look. These values form a representation of who we are as people and what we stand for. Ernesto Nieto also said in the first chapter of his book that being good sons, respectful of others, and obedience is his family's code. Presently, in the United States, Latinos possess the number one buying power. Without any integration whatsoever, imagine the kind of impact we can create under a unified, hemispheric, social identity. Under the Latino Decalogue, we can promote our own political agendas and hold more power in government. Under the Latino Decalogue, our federal officials will have no choice but to address the issues pertinent to our agenda, and firms within the economy will be forced to respond to our needs. Ernesto Nieto stated in the final chapter of his book that the challenge of the National Hispanic Institute is to institute a community belief system capable of leading Latino youth in a different direction. The Latino Decalogue I have created does just that, by giving the channel to the Latino youth of finding a new viewpoint while still enveloping who they are and where their ancestors originated. The impact this will have is that we do not surrender our cultural identity, but that we build upon it together as one people. Thank you.
Please hold all of your applause until the very end. Please hold all of your applause until the very end of oratory. Speaker 2, you have 5 minutes for your presentation.
Buenas tardes, mi nombre es Rocío Nairi Garza Gómez. Vivimos en un mundo en el que la comunidad latina está creciendo exorbitantemente. En Estados Unidos, esto significa que para el año 2050, la comunidad latina va a ser un tercio de toda la población americana. En otros números, esto significa que si hoy uno de cada 6 americanos es hispano, en el año 2050 uno de cada 4 lo será. En Estados Unidos existe un Instituto Nacional de Hispanos, NHI. Este instituto tiene la misión, de acuerdo a lo que dijo su fundador, Ernesto Nieto, en el libro de la Tercera Realidad, tiene la misión de apoyar a la juventud latina a ser exitosa, asistir a la universidad, ser profesionistas y tener sus propios negocios. ¿Qué significa esto? Que este instituto, NHI, busca apoyar a la juventud latina e impulsarla. En un futuro, NHI podría expandirse internacionalmente y convertirse en una institución internacional que beneficie y apoye a toda la juventud a lo largo del hemisferio para crear una identidad hemisférica. Es por eso que entonces se le podrá dar a la juventud latina un nuevo futuro, una nueva perspectiva a lo que pueden lograr hacer. Ahora imagínense, levantarse todos los días a trabajar desde que amanece hasta que anochece, con la única esperanza de poder alimentar a tu familia. Los latinos viven y trabajan arduamente para superarse, y es por eso que donde quiera que vayas vas a encontrar una comunidad latina en este hemisferio. Los latinos trabajan no para vivir, sino para sobrevivir. Yo he visto esto al ayudar a los inmigrantes que han cruzado. Han cruzado arriesgándose a todo, a perder su país, su hogar, su familia, su patrimonio, perderlo todo por la esperanza de un futuro mejor. Pero ahora imagínense, qué tan fácil su vida sería si tuvieran un título universitario. Esta educación es una herramienta indispensable hoy en día para superarse y salir adelante. Mi abuelo, quien no recibió ninguna educación, supo cuán importante era y luchó arduamente para que sus hijos sí la tuvieran. Y es por esa educación que mi mamá recibió que hoy yo estoy aquí, para promover un movimiento que una toda la comunidad latina por medio de la educación. Porque una educación es lo que hace que tu oficina no sea un semáforo, sino sea una oficina de verdad. Este movimiento se va a llamar Generaciones Latinas, porque es justo lo que buscamos. Generaciones que estén mejor preparadas y con mejores oportunidades para sobresalir. Mi movimiento tiene una visión similar a aquella de la que Ernesto Nieto tenía. Busca crear un nuevo motivo para el cual la juventud pueda crecer. Hoy en día, el motivo que tienen es el de las limitaciones, el de que se les limita qué pueden hacer y en qué pueden aspirar. Nosotros no buscamos eso. Nosotros queremos que su potencial sea su único límite y que ellos determinen qué es lo que pueden lograr hacer y que no sean determinados. Otra cosa que dijo Ernesto Nieto es la que se debe reconocer sus capacidades y sus esfuerzos. Toda la juventud latina hoy en día tiene ganas, sueños y esperanzas. Ahora, si nosotros le unimos a esas ganas un título universitario, esos sueños y esas esperanzas se van a volver una realidad tangible. Nosotros podemos, con el mismo movimiento, darles una oportunidad que de otra forma no tendrían acceso a tener. Mi movimiento va a impactar socialmente, porque estos jóvenes van a aprender a socializar, organizar eventos y salir adelante. Va a afectar políticamente, porque se van a borrar las fronteras, porque este movimiento va a recaudar fondos para un fondo de becas, para que asistan a la universidad y se eduquen. Si reciban una educación de la cual de otra forma no tendrían oportunidad de recibir. Este movimiento va a borrar las fronteras, porque no va a importar de qué nacionalidad seas, sino que tengas las ganas, el deseo, la pasión de poder salir adelante, de querer luchar por un futuro mejor. Va a afectar intelectualmente porque se va a recibir la oportunidad de la educación. Se van a abrir puertas que para ellos están cerradas. Se va a abrir la cultura porque se va a reconocer de lo que somos capaces los latinos. Se va a mostrar nuestro orgullo hispano y nuestra identidad. Vamos a demostrar de qué somos capaces porque vamos a unir nuestro deporte, la pasión, la comida, el idioma y todo aquello que nos hace ser quienes somos. Va a afectar económicamente porque mi movimiento va a ser una inversión al futuro. Una inversión que se va a cobrar porque cuando un país tiene gente educada, es un país con mejor economía que aquellos países con tercermundistas, con personas mal educadas. Mi movimiento va a ser exitoso porque va a ser así como somos nosotros los latinos. Va a ser exitoso. Gracias.
Please hold all applause until after the very end of oratory. The oratory question is, what kind of leaders will be most drawn to your social movement? And what asset do they bring to your efforts? What kind of leaders will be most drawn to your social movement, and what asset do they bring to your efforts?
You have 1 minute to prepare. Speaker one, you have 2 minutes to give your response to the question.
So my Latino Duck Log is based on the values and principles of our society. Now, what leaders will be attracted to this would be those of religious leaders, would be those of communities where the majority of the participants are mostly Latino. Now, the reason why I say these two specifically is because among the people in our community, we mostly look towards our leaders for a sense of confidence. We look towards them to help lead us in the correct direction of where we want to advance in our community. Now, of course, I also say religious leaders. And the reason why I say that is because the Latino Decalogue was originally conceived as an alternative to the Ten Commandments. Now, as I said before, as we are all, most of us, I would believe, are adherents to the Christian faith. Now, in the Christian faith, we have the Ten Commandments, which are 10 rules relating to religion. But the reason why I created the Latino Decalogue was because this is something relating to culture, something that can unify us under the de facto rules of our society that have not been written down and that have not been set in stone. What I also say is that both of these people have a major impact on our society. We mostly look towards the preachers to give us homilies which tell us what we need to implement in our daily lives. And the reason why we need to have the Latino Decalogue is to the fact that we need to have something that we live with our daily lives. The de facto rules of our society need to be implemented. Yes, we know them as common knowledge, but we do not see them as something that is concrete. It's an abstract thing currently. Now, as my closing, I would like to say that both religious leaders and leaders of communities were mostly consisting of Latinos will of course go with this because this is what they believe as well. They believe that this will be something that can change the Latino community for the better. Thank you.
Speaker two, you have 2 minutes.
What if instead of where we were sitting right now, we were out in the sun working hard all day, earning a horrible pay for a hard day work? Well, these are the circumstances many Latino youth face every day, and they have a hope for a better future. What would we do to help them? My movement, Generaciones Latinas, is trying to change that. It's trying to give them a better future, a better opportunity to succeed in life. Because they have the will, the determination, and the power to do so, but they need the impulse that we can provide for them with my movement. The leaders who will be drawn to my movement will be those leaders who have the motivation, who have the will, the strength, the independence, and the passion to succeed in life. They're going to be the people who are going to go out into the world and create an impact. It will be youth leaders who will grow up with the education they have received and will create a better world for all of our future kids to have. It will be attracted to leaders who will have a better understanding of what needs to be done to help everyone. Leaders who want everyone to have the opportunity they received and have a better chance at life and success. What my opponent fails to realize with his Latino Decalogue is that a Decalogue is limiting them. It's limiting them more because it's establishing rules for them to live by. What happens is with these Latino countries, they already have the pressure of the government, and if they're Catholic, they have the Ten Commandments. We will now add another burden for them to follow. What will happen if they break this burden? Will they be charged with accuses? What will be their punishment to this? How will the country react if someone breaks this Decalogue? My movement goes a step further and is trying to change this, because a person with education is a person who will go out into the world and create a better change, not a negative effect. It will be a person who will be smart and well prepared to succeed in our life. Thank you.
Extemporaneous speaking, and again, I just want to just give a friendly reminder to hold all applauses. I know we've had some great presentations out here, and our first reaction and instinct is to applaud them, but let's just hold off until the very end of the debate so that they can remain calm and move forward. At this time, I'd like to call to the stage our extemporaneous speaking finalist, representing Pro, Mr. Andrew McCullen from El Paso. Causes a problem. So if I see them up here. Thought they were here. If you give us a few minutes, because I'd like to move on to mock trial immediately afterwards, but to remind for you visitors that are here and from parents, we added a new addition to the great debate, which replaced adjudication. Actually, before that was impromptu. Replaced by adjudication and moved on to Athenium. And Athenium allows the students who did not participate in the Sweet 16 to go still represent their region in a newly formed debate in which each region were given a question and a prompt, and they had to discuss within their region and identify their best speaker to represent them against the other regions in a two-minute response to a question that was given. We've had three rounds up until this point. The rules were that you had to have a separate speaker for each event, each round, but they could not repeat. In the fourth round, they could either select one of the previous speakers or identify a fourth speaker for that. So today you will see either a new representative or someone that participated in one of the previous three rounds. And so we'll see that at the conclusion after mock trial. Then we will dismiss to dinner and then reconvene later on in the afternoon. So I get the cue up here that our extemp finalists are here. So representing Pro from El Paso, Andrew McCullen, and representing Con, Mr. Pierce Davis. Judges, I've asked the representative from Pro to read the question so that we all know what their answer. Or if you have the question, you can go ahead and share that as well. At this time, I'm going to turn it over to our tournament director and our final judges.
The topic for extemp is: schools should provide students with the choice of what cultures and countries they wish to study about instead of following prescribed curriculums. Pro, you have 5 minutes for your presentation.
The difference between a successful person and others is not a lack of strength or a lack of knowledge, but rather a lack of will. This was said by Ernesto Nieto in his Third Reality. You see, the beliefs are, if you were to give people, students, the chance to select the education that they want to have, if you were to give them the opportunity to have the shot at picking their curriculum, I believe that they would have more of an initiative to want to learn it. They would want to actually show up to class on the daily. They would actually want to do their homework. Right now, having the set curriculum, learning things that sometimes people don't even care about. People are encouraged to ditch. They're encouraged to just not do homework. Some people don't even care about grades anymore. But if you had the shot to pick what you want to learn and pick the curriculum, you would want to learn. You'd have more power, you'd have more control, and basically just the chance to learn anything you want. Of course with some guidelines, but anything you can imagine, you could learn. Isn't that what we all want as young students, young adults, regardless if we're in high school, middle school, elementary school, or even college? If you could learn what you want, I guarantee you those test scores would shoot up. Just under 48% of Latinos of the age of 16 through 25 want to obtain a bachelor's degree. That percent's not very high. But if they could choose what they want to learn, that percent would shoot up. That percent would give America a name. Our test scores as the U.S. is not terrific. They're not great, but they're good. But we want to be up there in terrific and great. And if we had the opportunity to learn what we want to learn, they could be great. They will be great. The Latino community will have the influence for that to be great, the influence for it to happen, all because of the Latino community. 77% of Latinos ages 16 through 25 say they think college is the most important thing to do right as soon as they get out of high school. High school. Most of us here are in high school. And myself, I'm not too crazy about school because I don't get to choose what I want to learn. But if I could choose whatever I want to learn, I'd be the person there sitting in the front of the class. I'd be doing my homework every day. I would show up to class every day. And I'm not saying I already don't, but now I would have a motivation. I would have a reason to want to be there. I would have a purpose. It's very important that the Hispanic community has an input on what education is going to become. Because by the year 2050, the U.S.'s population is going to be two-thirds Hispanic. We are going to be not only the majority and the minority, but we are going to be the U.S. One day, the Hispanic community will be the U.S. And if we act now, and we get our voice out there, and we get our ideas out there, and we have our assets brought to the table, we will have a name. We will already start to begin to gain the respect the Latino community deserves now. So that way, when it comes to the time by 2050, when we are the majority and the minority, when it comes to that point in life, we're already up there. We're already respected. We're not having to try our best to gain respect from the other races and other ethnicities. We're already going to be there. But that is up to us now, up to us today. So in the long run, to get up to that point, to be the people that make the decisions, we need a good education. And with that good education, we can make our decisions. But when getting the education, that's where we come in. That's where we get to pick what we want to learn. And if we pick what we want to learn, we're going to know it all. If we actually have a motivation to know it, we're going to know it all. Back, front, side, other side, diagonal, we're going to know the education that we want to learn. We have a motivation. The Hispanic community alone, together today, needs to act. And as soon as we act, we can have a purpose. And I'm not saying we don't have a purpose now, but that purpose can grow. By the year 2050, we will be the reason the U.S. has great test scores. We are the Hispanics. Thank you.
Khan, you have 1 minute to prepare a question.
No further time is needed.
You have 1 minute to ask your question.
For the entirety of my opponent's speech, he stressed one key point, that we would want to go to school if we had a choice. But according to the Pew Research Center, statistically today, the dropout rates for Hispanics are at an all-time low, the lowest they have been in decades. So the question that I would like to ask my opponent is, why would we change the one thing that statistically is working for us when a curriculum is already providing us the best education we can get and students already want to go to school?
Pro, you have 1 minute to prepare an answer.
No further time needed.
My opponent asked, why would we want to change the curriculum if we're at an all-time low of dropouts? Well, if we could change the curriculum to what the Hispanic culture wanted, wouldn't that decrease the percentage of dropouts? Wouldn't that want Hispanics to, I don't know, maybe cause them to actually lower that? Wouldn't that cause Hispanics to pick what they want to learn? Wouldn't that affect their perspective? Isn't it all about perspectives? If we could change their perspective and have them want to go to school more than they already do and lower that percentage, wouldn't that make the high school dropout percentage even lower? And isn't that our goal?
Khan, you have 5 minutes for your presentation.
Ernesto Nieto himself, our founder of the National Hispanic Institute, once said that voice is for those who will lead tomorrow. And our voice is our strong educational background, because knowledge is power, and through that power, our voice will be heard throughout the nation. I'm Pierce Davis, and good afternoon. And the topic at hand today is, should we continue the strict educational curriculum that we have today? And the answer, quite simply, is yes. We must stick with the educational curriculum that we have today due to growth, education, and empowerment. Growth. According to the NHI website itself and the Pew Research Center, by the year 2050, actually 1 in 5 citizens in the United States today will be Hispanic. And that does mean that we will be the majority. But the thing is, if we're going to run the nation, we need structure. Because as history has shown, nothing without structure has succeeded. The structure that we hope to lay the foundation for our Latino community is that education. And that education is what we already have in place, and it's what already is working. We are called the United States of America for a reason, because we are not united through education. We are not called the separated states. We are united through our educational curriculum. And that takes me to education itself. Education is the groundwork. Today, the Pew Research Center has calculated that the dropout rate for Hispanics is at an all-time low. 14% to be exact. And this is a milestone, because this is the lowest that it has been for decades. And that means we're doing something right, because it has continued to drop and to drop and to drop as decades go by. And if it follows the same pattern as predicted by the Pew Research Center, it will become lower if we stick to this curriculum that we have in place today,
that is working. Because we are learning and we are wanting to go to school today. Because we agree that education is completely necessary. And that takes me to empowerment. The Pew Research Center has calculated that 88% of all Hispanics above the age of 16 agree that the curriculum is working and, more importantly, that college is necessary. And that in itself is the answer to the theme and the topic that I was presented with. The question was, should we stick to the curriculum? And our Latino community has already given you the answer to the question. We agree that what we're doing is working. We agree that it's a necessary part in order to obtain the high standard of living that we hope to achieve to reach the NHI mission of representation and equality in this nation. So if we truly want to answer the question, all we need to do is listen to ourselves as the Latino community, because we have already given an answer that yes, what we are doing is working. It's making us want to go to school, and we realize now that it's necessary. Because when we get an education, we realize that that will lead to a job in the future. And that job will lead to wealth and money. And that wealth in turn will lead to opportunity. And opportunity will always lead to more wealth. And finally, that wealth will lead to power. And with power, we can voice our opinion as the Latino community and be a strong majority in the near future. But it all started with the education we received that we all agree upon is strong and strict in today's nation. Education is the key to voicing our opinion as the Latino community. Growth, education, and empowerment are the three evident reasons that what we're doing today is working. Our strict educational system provides an incentive for us to want to learn. As Ernesto Nieto said, those who have a voice will lead the future. We are obtaining our voice now more than ever through education. And that education is what makes us strong and proud to call ourselves the Latino community, because that's what we are. We are the proud, educated Latino community. Thank you.
Bro, you have 1 minute to prepare a question. Time. Pro, you have 1 minute to ask your question.
As my opponent continued to state that the dropout percent has lowered and is at an all-time low, that does not exactly include the students that are attending school but don't choose to turn in their work, those that get bad grades, and those that just don't really care about the curriculum in general. So my question is, how are we supposed to motivate those that don't even turn in their work or even care to listen in class? How do we motivate them to actually care to learn about the curriculum, to actually care about what the teachers are teaching in class? How do we motivate them to want to learn if they're not enjoying what they're learning?
Khan, you have 1 minute to prepare an answer.
Time is needed.
You have 1 minute to give your response.
My opponent states today that they don't want to learn and they aren't motivated. But statistically, that's the 14%, which is at an all-time low. You cannot argue mathematics, and that is what a strong curriculum teaches you, to base it off of sound facts. And today, the other percent, not the 14, but it's the majority that are going to class and are learning. Because our strong educational curriculum is an incentive for a better quality of life, which will lead in turn to the successful completion of the NHI mission. The vast majority want to continue to go to school and learn through our strong curriculum, and that's what they're doing. And those that may not want to learn or listen are the minority, and they continue to drop every year. But at the end of the day, the majority go to school to learn, and they learn through our strong educational curriculum.
Ladies and gentlemen, a big round of applause for our extemporaneous speaking finalists. Program is slowly coming to an end. Now we've got mock trial. Remember that in mock trial, I already heard the woo. In mock trial, there will be a debate. And we ask that you keep your comments and the noise down. We ask that you hold all applauses until, again, the end of the debate. We've already determined who will serve as the plaintiff and who will serve as the defense. So help me welcome the attorney for the plaintiff from Houston, Aaron Gutierrez. And representing the witness from Houston, Alexander Valdez. Next up, representing the defense and serving as the attorney, Jared Cáceres. And Jared is representing San Antonio, and also the witness for the defense from San Antonio, Allison Reyna. Gentlemen, we're now going to begin the mock trial. Finalist judges, I'll turn it over to you.
The mock trial topic is Publishers of Latin American and U.S. Latino history in its current forms inhibit the development of a common purpose and pursuit of solidarity among people who share historical, cultural, and linguistic similarities and backgrounds. Plaintiff, you have 2 minutes for your opening statement. Time starts when you do.
Your Honor, may I finish the floor?
Yes, you may.
Your Honor, may I begin? Your Honor and opposing counsel, may it please the court. My name is Aaron Gutierrez, and I am here with my partner and witness, Alexander Valdez, to clearly prove that the topic which we pose as the plaintiff, which states that publishers of Latin American and United States Latino history in its current forms inhibit the development of a common purpose and pursuit of solidarity among people who share historical, cultural, and linguistic similarities and backgrounds is completely and utterly true, Your Honor. I would like to prove this with the following three areas of analysis. First, being that by the publishers not allowing for the unity of us as a Latino community, we are losing our language, Your Honor. Only 38% of third-generation United States Latinos in America speak Spanish. 38%, Your Honor. That is not even 2 of every 5 third-generation Latinos in America. Your Honor, my second area of analysis is that publishers are inhibiting the development of hemispheric leaders through the installation of fragmentalism in curriculums. Fragmentalism being the teaching of a framework, bits and pieces of a culture, rather than teaching everything you need to know about the culture to thrive in that particular culture. My last area of analysis is that through the inhibition of a common purpose, we as a Latino community are losing our culture. Only 3% of third-generation Latinos in America listen to only Spanish music. 3%, Your Honor. And even a lower 2% watch only Spanish TV. 2%. Your Honor, with the previously stated areas of analysis, along with factors found in Social Utility Code, especially factors A, B, and E, and using examples from Ernesto Nieto's The Third Reality, Crafting of a 21st Century Latino Agenda, we would like to clearly prove our argument today. Your Honor, we as the plaintiff do hold the burden of proof, and we do in fact wish to uphold it. Thank you, Your Honor. May I be seated?
Yes, you may. Defense, you have 2 minutes for your opening statement.
Your Honor, permission to give my opening statement? Your Honor, my name is Jared Cáceres, the attorney for the defense, and this is my expert witness, Allison Reyna. Today, we intend to prove that we are not in violation of the subsections A, B, and E of the Social Utility Code. The trial at hand today states that the current information being provided by the Latino and U.S. Latino history publishers is currently inhibiting the Latino community. Today, we intend to disprove these accusations that the plaintiff has wrongly accused us of. Your Honor, today, the main topic that is necessary for us to focus on is the education and the youth of the Latino community. Your Honor, the youth of today, the youth of the Latino community, hold very malleable minds. These minds have the ability to be shaped into exponential things. And this opportunity that the Latino community has to make these minds what they believe they should be, and make these minds a mind that promotes the values and the cultural backgrounds of the Latino community. By forming these young minds with this value of a pride to look to their community, to search for an identity for themselves, to search for comfort within an area, the Latino community is further progressing itself. Your Honor, education has always been a prominent value to the Latino community. And if we do not dwell on the Latino community and its education, as well as the future, we will be just stuck looking to the past and not promoting the future of the Latino community and its great aspirations that I have for it and that I hope the whole Latino community has for it as well.
Time. Plaintiff, you have 3 minutes to direct examine your witness.
Your Honor, may my witness approach the bench?
He may.
I swear by the NHI Honor Code to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. So help me, NHI.
You can be seated.
Your Honor, may I approach the floor?
Yes, you may.
Your Honor, may I begin?
Yes, you may.
May you please state your name and occupation?
My name is Charles. Time will restart. Go ahead, counsel.
May you please state your name and occupation?
My name is Alexander Valdez, and I am witness for the plaintiff.
How does this topic affect the Latino community?
Well, Your Honor, clearly stated by the publishers themselves, they are inhibiting the promotion of success because they are promoting the idea that certain information should be taught in classrooms, which is fragmentism. And that alone goes to show that they are creating facades and mirages for what they themselves believe should be taught in classrooms. And that, Your Honor, is greatly affecting the Latino community. But I am a member of this Latino community. I represent what harm is being done in classrooms because I am a first generation of nine in my family, the first to have the highest level of education in my family. And that is because publishers are failing to meet even the most basic necessity and expectations required by students to learn. We are simply getting what they choose to teach us, not everything that is important about our culture, which does not promote factor A, whether it is in the rational self-interest of the entire Latino community, because it clearly is not promoting the rational self-interest. It is, in fact, inhibiting us to become leaders for successful futures that the opposing attorney has for us, a prominent future. How can a publisher have a prominent future if he himself is well aware that what's going on in these books is not full and the whole truth about culture and religion? The idea that they have about education is being limited and filtered, which ties into factor B. It does not promote the social, economic, political, intellectual, or cultural values in the Latino community. It, in fact, inhibits the development of leaders, and therefore inhibiting the leadership and promotion of success, which then ties into factor E. If we do not have access to this education that we were born to have, how are we supposed to have a pursuit of happiness, life, or liberty, because we are not allotted the education that the publishers are failing to give us? Your Honor, I would like to restate that the publishers are failing to give us even the most basic knowledge because of what they feel is important to us, which is detrimental not only to me as an affected Latino in the community, but I myself represent a minuscule percentage of people who are like me, teens in high school, are not getting this education. So if I represent a minuscule amount, by 2050, if one-third of the population is Latino, imagine the number going up significantly, impacting the entire Latino community. Students will choose to drop out because the education that they're receiving is half. Not everything they're receiving is full, and that is not right, Your Honor. It impedes and imposes the process of a leader becoming a leader because we are not learning all there is to know. Being filtered and unobligated to get this education goes to show that publishers are unaware of what they're doing and why it's wrong.
Thank you, Your Honor. May I be seated?
Yes, you may. Defense, you have 3 minutes for your cross-examination.
Your Honor, permission to begin my cross-examination?
Yes, you may.
You are a member of the Latino community, correct?
Obviously, this question is being listening to what I was stating earlier.
Can you myself write
the
sentence? That is sufficient.
Furthermore, elaborate.
Thank you, that is sufficient.
Do not care about
as
the elaboration that we have. Therefore,
as
a
Latino
the idea that we are
not aware of the origin of the standardized tests and tests that the students today take in order to pass and graduate.
The idea that they are giving us tests that make sure that we are not able to able to succeed.
Are you aware that the publishers of Latino and U.S. Latino history do not produce these tests that are provided by these school systems?
So you're saying publishers do not produce these tests? Are you not a publisher?
Yes, I am a publisher.
Okay, so then, Your Honor, as previously stated by the attorney,
Do you know why we are
trial at hand today? Responsible for publishing these tests.
Do you know why we are trial at hand today?
We are here because publishers are inhibiting
yes.
Success.
And what are we publishers of? What are we publishers of?
Can you rephrase your question?
What are we publishers of?
Are
you aware that the Latino publishers are publishers of history and not the broad environment of education?
So you're saying you don't have control as a publisher of what we're going to talk about?
Are you implying that as a publisher of Latino U.S. history and U.S. and Latino history, that we must cover the curriculum of an English class or a math class?
As a publisher, you can't even meet. I don't understand.
Would you say that one of these criteria of the U.S. Latino and Latino history publishers is to meet the requirements of other pieces of education that aren't even involved within history?
We are not talking about the specifics of history, but the idea of unification of
history today.
We are talking about how we share more than just historical.
You claim that the Latino community has a linguistic barrier, correct?
We do not have a linguistic barrier because we are, as Latinos, trying hard to preserve what we have left of our culture because it is being prohibited and filtered by publishers like you.
That is
which
sufficient.
Is why we are unable to continue on the
sufficient.
In the Latino
and
community,
are you
which is why we see less and less representation of the government in the Latino community, which is why we are not being represented in the Latino community.
Audience, please keep quiet. Plaintiff, you have 1 minute for your redirect examination.
Your Honor, may I approach the floor?
Yes, you may.
Your Honor, may I begin? Is there anything that was stated in your cross-examination that you would like to clear up for the court?
I would like to not only impose the idea that the attorney is aware of the standardized testing that they are giving us, but is also aware that they are in charge of the knowledge that we are not receiving. And if they are aware of the knowledge that we are not receiving, why would they choose to inhibit the amount of education that we get? Why, as a person who wants to learn, why am I not allowed to have access to that education? Why? Because publishers feel the need to censor the knowledge that we get is not right. It is not fair because it is not promoting success in the Latino community, which according to Third Reality is already being seen as a negative because of the amount of violence and gang-related affiliations that we have in the Latino community. Because publishers are failing to educate us about such topics, which goes to show that publishers have no sense of morality when it comes to the Latino community. Furthermore, interjecting the idea that they do not care about the Latino community, Your Honors.
That is all, ma'am. Be seated.
Yes, you may. Defense, you have 1 minute for your recross examination.
Your Honor, permission to begin my recross examination. Are you claiming, as it seemed that you did within your redirect examination, that as Latino and U.S. Latino publishers of history, we are required to provide all the education that is needed?
Are you saying that you are not responsible for the education that we receive in classrooms?
Are you claiming that we are responsible for the entire education of the Latino community?
I am appalled that you would stand there and ask me a question with the audacity that you are unaware that you
are a publisher.
In your redirect
examination that we do not have a sense of morality, correct?
Yes, because you were standing here asking.
And are you aware that within textbooks we provide objective information?
Do you mean subjective information? Because it is being filtered and fragmented.
Are you aware that the Latino and U.S. Latino publishers of history are providing subjective history?
Subjective history.
Objective history.
It is being fragmented and it is being censored because we are not gaining
time.
Thank you.
Audience, please remain quiet.
Your Honor, may my witness be seated?
Yes, he may. Defense, you have 3 minutes for the direct examination of your witness.
Your Honor, permission for my witness to be sworn in?
Yes, she may.
I swear by the NHI Honor Code that I promise to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the honor truth. The whole truth. I swear by the NHI.
Your Honor, permission to begin my direct examination.
You may.
Allison, how do you feel about the topic at hand today?
Good afternoon, Your Honor. My name is Allison Reyna, and I intend to prove today that the defense is not in violation of subsections A, B, and E, as the plaintiff has so ridiculously accused us of. Subsection A denotes whether it is in the rational self-interest of the Latino community. Your Honor, our textbooks are providing unbiased, factual information about what has happened before us in a way that is at the highest caliber possible. And by providing this educational stimulation for the Latino community to allow them to grow and become invested in history and education, I don't see how that could at all be detrimental to the progress of the rational self-interest of the Latino community. In fact, I would say that it's beneficial to the educational growth of the Latino community and inspiring them to become more invested in what they are learning at school. Subsection B denotes whether it promotes the social, political, intellectual, cultural, and economic progress of the Latino community. Your Honor, the plaintiff has insisted numerous times that we include cultural education in our textbooks, and I would like to state that it is not the job of a history textbook to provide cultural information. Culture, especially one of the Latino community, is something that is so vast, so beautiful, so intangible, it cannot be represented through a textbook. It is something that is best learned by interactions with members of one's own community, specifically the Latino community today. And through promoting this more efficient method of being educated about one's own culture and one's own background and who they are, we are promoting the development of young Latino leaders who will grow into the leaders that this Latino community needs to progress and step in the right direction. They will be informed about the right decisions to make to progress the community in a way that we deserve. Subsection E denotes whether it is in whether it promotes the life, liberty, and happiness of the Latino community. Your Honor, as I have stated previously, our textbooks are not only promoting young Latino students to become invested in history that is taught at school, but also to become invested in their own cultures and their own backgrounds by learning about it in a more efficient, effective manner through their own Latino community. This, I feel, is why the defense is not in violation of subsections A, B, and E, because we are providing everything that we are required to, if not more, and we are promoting the development of leaders that will catapult us into the future in the way that the Latino community deserves, with progress and with confidence.
And do you agree with Ernesto Nieto's statement saying that history textbooks were, or books were no longer necessary? Family histories were passed down by story.
What I believe Mr. Nieto is saying through this statement is that history textbooks have a time and place. And that time and place is not to provide cultural education, but rather to provide objective history and facts and things that have happened that are not refutable. But culture and family stories are something that are best passed down by people, speaking to other people, and gaining a full understanding of it in that way.
No further time, Your Honor.
Plaintiff, you have 3 minutes for your cross-examination.
Your Honor, may I approach the floor?
Yes, you may. Audience, please remain quiet.
Your Honor, may I begin?
Yes, you may.
What is the common purpose of the Latino community?
A common purpose can be defined by many things, and it means something different to many different people.
Okay, thank
people.
You, but what is the exact common purpose of the Latino community?
As I have stated previously, that is up to the individual to decide.
Okay, thank you. So the Latino community as a whole does not have a common purpose?
That's extrapolating and not true at all. What I said is that people can have many different common purposes.
Okay, thank you. Then what is your common purpose as a Latino?
I would say that my common purpose as a Latino is to inspire leaders and to encourage them.
Okay,
you know.
Now, where did you learn this common purpose?
Where did I find this common purpose? By interacting with members of my own community, not
okay,
a textbook.
Okay, thank you. Why did you not look to your own publications for this common purpose?
Because our publications are not meant to provide this, but instead provide...
Okay, thank you. Is culture already instilled in textbooks today?
No, I don't believe it is, because...
Okay, thank you. So then what do you learn in Spanish class?
I take French class, actually.
Okay, thank you. So what do you learn? What do people who take Spanish class learn?
They learn about the Spanish language, but that is up to them.
Okay, thank you. Could you name for me a specific curriculum that encourages the Latino leadership in textbooks?
Our textbooks are providing history, which is in turn...
Okay, thank you. So your textbooks are providing history.
Of course they are providing history.
Okay,
that's what we're talking
so
about
are they providing
today.
The Latino
your
history?
Honor, objection, rule 3, conduct. Many times, this attorney is refusing to listen to my witness's expert testimony, which will benefit the trial tremendously. And if we listen to this trial, the whole group attending this trial will understand why the defense is not in violations of these subsections.
Response?
Your Honor, I have gotten the answer that I would like to, and I would like to move on to the following question so that we may use the court's time wisely and correctly rather than spending them on foolish answers.
One more response?
Your Honor, this idea that we only need the response that he needs is not progressing this trial at all. The trial needs a full understanding from the judges. And without this expert testimony being provided to the judges, we cannot further progress this trial.
I'm overruling to Rule 3, conduct. Feel free to make another objection if you have another.
No further time, Your Honor.
Okay, thank you. Could you name for me a specific curriculum that encourages the Latino community in textbooks today?
How can I name one specific curriculum when our textbooks are encouraging them in many different ways?
Okay, thank you. Would you say that language is important in a culture?
I would say that there are many different aspects that make up culture, and language happens to be one of them.
Okay, thank you. Are you aware that only 38% of third-generation United States Latinos speak Spanish?
I'm aware that Spanish is not the only language that is important to the Latino community.
Okay, thank you. But are you aware that only 38% of third-generation United States Latino speak Spanish?
Why is that relevant to today's case?
Objection, Your Honor. Rule 505, non-responsive witness. I clearly asked the question if she was aware of this statistic, which states 38% of third-generation United States Latino speak Spanish, and she questioned the relevancy, which is a complete tangent onto what I asked a question of.
Response?
Your Honor, my witness has the obligation to not answer a question if it is not relevant to this case, and it will not progress this case at all. Your Honor, the linguistic barrier that he is talking about is not defining the Latino community as a whole.
One more response.
Your Honor, in the issue proper for trial, it states that the publishers are inhibiting the common purpose and pursuit of solidarity among people who share historical, cultural, and linguistic similarities. So clearly, what the question that I've posed is relevant to the topic.
Sustained.
Are you aware that only 38% of third-generation United States Latinos speak Spanish?
I am absolutely aware of the statistic.
Okay, thank
as a
you.
Publisher
so why would you say that losing our language is a good thing?
We are not losing our language because
okay,
there are multiple
you.
Languages to begin
okay,
with.
Okay, thank you. Are you aware of fragmentalism in curriculums?
Fragmentalism is subjective and is not something that I think.
Okay, thank you. But
today.
did your attorney not state that the curriculums are objective?
Fragmentalism is a concept that is subjective, but the information that we are providing is something that is objective,
okay, thank
factual,
you. So then how is fragmentalism subjective and the curriculums in which fragmentalism is in objective?
Your Honor, what we are discussing today is the effect that these history textbooks
okay, thank
have
you.
On
that
the community.
That is all the time I need, Your Honor. May I be seated?
Yes, you may. Defense, you have 1 minute for redirect examination of your witness.
Your Honor, permission to redirect examine my witness.
Yes, you may. Audience, please keep quiet.
Allison, is there anything that you'd like to reiterate or exemplify to the court that happened in your cross-examination?
What I would like to reiterate to the court is that what we are discussing today is the effect that these textbooks are having on the Latino community. And what that effect is a promotion of leadership, a promotion of being inspired to become the leaders that this community needs. to become educated out of who they are and their culture by gaining a more efficient understanding of it, by talking to members of their own Latino community. One cannot be expected to provide answers that are so vast and so infinitesimal in a textbook that is meant to provide objective history about things that have happened in the past. Culture is something that is present and is ever-changing, and is not something that can be adequately represented through words on paper, especially through a textbook that is going to remain the same for a period of time, given as is a representation of history, things that have happened in the past and cannot change any further than they already have.
No further time needed, Your Honor.
Plaintiff, you have 1 minute for your recross examination.
No recross examination needed, Your Honor.
Your Honor, permission for my witness to leave the stand?
Yes, she may. Attorneys, you have 1 minute to prepare for closing arguments. Audience, please remain quiet. You have 2 minutes for your closing argument.
Your Honor, may I approach the floor?
Yes, you may.
Your Honor, may I begin? Your Honor, today we have clearly proven that the publishers of Latin American and United States Latino history in its current forms are inhibiting the development of a common purpose and pursuit of solidarity among people who share historical, cultural, and linguistic similarities and backgrounds. Today we have proved this through the cross-examination where the opposing counsel's witness herself stated that there is no Latino common purpose. Clearly, this is due to the publishers and what they are publishing and how they are misguiding and misconstruing knowledge and information given to the Latino community. The opposing counsel's witness is a prime example of how the Latino community does not know their common purpose, Your Honor. As stated in the background of the issue proper for trial, the common purpose is to pursue the development of hemispheric leaders, Your Honor. The opposing counsel's witness did not know this, clearly proving our argument, Your Honor. I'd also like to point out that she stated that she went to her own community to learn this common purpose, but obviously she did not even go to her own publications. This clearly proves how the publishers don't even believe in what they are publishing, Your Honor. The publishers are publishing misconstrued and misguided information that they do not even look to information themselves for, Your Honor. How are we, as the Latino community, supposed to trust the publishers of Latin America if they cannot even trust themselves? Your Honor, I would also like to point out that she stated that fragmentalism in their curriculums is subjective. How is this possible if the opposing counsel's attorney stated that their curriculums are objective? This is a clear contradiction, Your Honor. How is fragmentalism, which is instilled in curriculums, subjective if those curriculums themselves are objective? This makes no sense, Your Honor, clearly proving how the opposing counsel is unfit to argue this topic, Your Honor. Thank you. That is all the time I need. May I be seated?
Yes, you may. Defense, you have 3 minutes for your closing statement.
Your Honor, permission to give my closing statement. Your Honor, today in this trial, we have witnessed exactly what I had anticipated before this trial. We have witnessed that the plaintiff has failed to uphold this standard of proof that they are set to. And also, they have failed to prove that us, the defense, are in violations of subsections A, B, and E of the Social Utility Code. Your Honor, in my witness's direct examination, she claimed that the current methods promote a cultural enrichment within the community. And by doing this, we are promoting stronger leaders in the future and a stronger future for the Latino community as a whole. Your Honor, in the cross-examination of my witness, language was brought up as a prominent factor. And yes, it is a part of the issue proper for trial. But as a strong Latino community member, I do not believe that just because I cannot speak Spanish, I am not a part of the Latino community. I myself hold myself a very high member of the Latino community. And also, the methods of fragmentalism, which is not used by the defense today, is subjective. And the history that we provide is objective, as stated by my witness. And lastly, the cross-examination of the plaintiff's witness was a prime example of how confused the plaintiff is today. The plaintiff's witness failed to realize what we were providing today and what our job is to provide. They were not knowledgeable that we provide U.S. Latino and Latino history today, and not the entire education of the whole Latino community. Your Honor, the consequences of giving this round to the plaintiff are highly detrimental. By doing this, we could further negate the Latino community. And this trial is a prime example of the reason why we're here. And this trial is a prime example of why we shouldn't be here. The plaintiff accused us and is wasting time that they could be spending enriching their cultural values and enriching their personality and their identity in this trial. Your Honor, we need to promote this identity, this culture that we are promoting within our textbooks, and this value to seek an identity, this value to seek your own culture is a value that is very necessary in order for the Latino community to become a strong and prominent figure in the future to come.
Plaintiff, you have 1 minute for your summation.
Your Honor, may I approach the floor?
Yes, you may.
Your Honor, may I begin? Your Honor, the opposing counsel clearly has no regard for the Latino community. This can be found in the fact that they stated that by siding with us, the plaintiff, that y'all will further negate the Latino community. Further negate, saying that it has already been negated. This is completely false, Your Honor. The Latino community is prospering, not being negated. Your Honor, I would also like to point out that the publishers stated that they promote cultural enrichment in their curriculums, but in their direct examination, they stated that culture is not being and not needed to be implied into the curriculums. This is a clear contradiction in itself, Your Honor. If how are they promoting cultural enrichment in their publications if culture is not even in their publications, Your Honor? I'd also like to point out that the opposing counsel's witness stated that she was aware of fragmentalism, but the opposing counsel's attorney stated that they are not aware and it is not used. Your Honor, we have clearly proven the burden of proof along with our factors A, B, and E. Thank you, Your Honor. May I be seated?
Yes, you may.
Thank you.
for your 2015 Texas Great Debate mock trial finalists. If I could have all of the round four Athenium finalists take the stage. Welcome all of our project administrators. You can give them a round of applause. And do we have a timekeeper? Do we have a timekeeper? Timekeeper, and we will begin with our challenge. The question for round four of the Athenaeum is, the author writes, the challenge facing the National Hispanic Institute is to give rise to a community belief system capable of leading Latino youth in a different direction. One so compelling to attract them to develop a sense of exploration. The author, Ernesto Nieto, goes on to further state As a community, we have the capacity to create different pathways that add much needed value in training for future Latino leaders. Here is the charge. Comment on how you would free the minds of youth in your community in order to give rise to new community beliefs and to create different pathways for training new future Latino leaders.
Hello, my name is Rodrigo Sanchez, and I represent the region tip of Texas. Everyone, let's take a moment. Close your eyes and imagine this. Imagine you are traveling on a highway for 20 years, trying to achieve any size goal, but experience no change in the way you achieve it. Now change your perspective. Imagine you are traveling on that same highway and you realize that if we change, we will achieve that goal at a much faster rate, which will show the Latino community progression. Now, open your eyes and open your minds, because the National Hispanic Institute must have an open mentality to create this change, because it begins with all of you. Now, before I joined the National Hispanic Institute, I never considered myself a Latino leader. But since I decided to join the National Hispanic Institute, I realized that I am now a Latino leader. Now, as a Latino leader, I want to create change in the way we are helping the Latino community progress and in the way NHI should progress. Right now, NHI is teaching the youth a domestic type leadership of mentality. Now, this mentality is not good because we are only focusing on domestic issues rather than global issues. That is why I insist we teach a mentality of global progressive mentality. If we teach this mentality, we will teach the youth to want to explore the global Latino community as a whole and help them to want to create change in the Latino issues and not just on domestic issues. Now, we need someone to take a step forward. And I ask all of you a question from me to you. Are you willing to take this step forward? And are you willing to achieve this following my footsteps? Thank you.
We are now ready for speaker number two. Speaker number two for the judges. If we could please keep the applause to a minimum so the judges can hear names and regions. Eric Diaz from Houston. Speaker number one was Rodrigo Sanchez from the tip of Texas. Speaker number two, we're ready for you. His name is Eric Diaz, and he is from Houston.
I was walking in a park. As I walked, I came across an anthill. What I saw next amazed me. Each and every one of those ants working together for one common goal: to create a stable and secure environment. So this brought up the question, what about in our Pan-American society? Why can't we have countries such as the USA, Mexico, Chile, Honduras, etc., working together for one global goal to create a stable and secure environment? I'll tell you why.
Honor. My region and I have created a program that will pay an end to this. What have we done? We have gathered individuals from various countries in the Latin American community, such as Honduras, Mexico, Chile, Uruguay, etc. Put them in one area so they can share their cultures. How do we do this? Well, we have to learn with each other. Showing that the culture isn't something that's better, they can share it. And if it's better, we'll be an end of the world that they will share their cultures with each other. Like the way that Mason wrote this third reality, it says, if we don't show us the lowest level of risk, advancement is not possible. This is what we consider this in our program. Our program will end with nationalistic views. And because of these reasons, our program can in the world work. Thank you.
Again, judges, that was Eric Diaz from Houston. We will now welcome speaker number 3, Adrian Vasquez from the Rio Grande Valley.
What is encouragement? Easy. It's the support that you get from those when you are trying to reach a specific goal. And that is something that the Latino community needs to have. Encouragement. Specifically for those, the Latino youth, that are going to be the future leaders of the Latinos of later generations. I would like to start off by saying that as a Latino community, we need to have strong community beliefs, and those beliefs should be involving working together and being united as one whole. Because when you are united and when you work together, it is evident that you will be much stronger than if you were as an individual. We also need to provide a different pathway in order to teach these Latino youth on how to learn and understand about the Latino community. And the way that we can do that is if we provide retreats and camps that the Latino youth can go to be able to participate in activities that can help benefit them in the future. These activities can be hands-on, and anything hands-on is very beneficial for the youth because that is how we learn. Hands-on can allow for you to have fun, but also learn something at the same time. And when you learn something, you keep it in you forever, and you'll be much smarter than you ever were before without it. Ernesto Nieto once said that encouragement is something that the Latino youth need in order to be successful. And let's encourage the Latino youth by allowing them this idea of letting them learn in a much fun way and at a much easier way that they can understand everything. Because with encouragement, we will get anywhere and everywhere we want. With encouragement, we are allowed as Latino youth to be motivated to strive for success, to strive for something that we want. And if that success is to be Latino leaders for our future, then let it be. With encouragement, we will accomplish anything. And we can accomplish being the best and brightest Latino leaders that the Latino community has ever had throughout history. Thank you.
Again, that was Mr. Adrian Vasquez from the RGB. We now welcome speaker number 4, Emiliano Pastrano from San Antonio. Emiliano Pastrano from San Antonio. Thank you.
Los líderes no se hacen, los líderes nacen. Cada uno de nosotros, cada miembro de la comunidad hispana tiene la capacidad de ser un líder poderoso. Muchos de nosotros no lo aceptamos. Nos da miedo la capacidad y el poder que tendríamos al ser líderes. Pero de vez en cuando surge alguna persona como César Chávez o Emiliano Zapata que no les da miedo y explotan esas habilidades para unir a una comunidad y hacerlos que luchen por un bien común. Hola, soy Emiliano Pastrana y represento a la ciudad de San Antonio. En este round se nos dio la tarea de crear una idea que liberara las mentes de los jóvenes latinos, que les diera la motivación y los recursos necesarios para poder pensar como líderes. Nuestra idea fue crear un centro comunitario latino llamado Jóvenes Líderes Latinos. En este centro, los jóvenes latinos aprenderían a ver sobre su cultura, su religión, a hablar español y aprendería sobre todo sobre los valores de las comunidades latinas y a cómo usarlas para liderar. Los jóvenes latinos serían motivados para asistir a las juntas, que serían 4 veces a la semana, y en cada mes habría un tema diferente. Depende, ya sea cómo iniciar un movimiento para cambiar una comunidad o incluso cómo inspirar a las personas. Tendríamos invitados que les darían consejos y que les darían la motivación necesaria para ser líderes. Como ya les dije, los líderes no se hacen, los líderes nacen. Y todos tenemos la capacidad suficiente. Solo necesitamos la motivación y los recursos necesarios para poder surgir. Gracias.
From San Antonio. We now welcome speaker number 5, Dominic Blair from Austin. Speaker number 5, Dominic Blair from Austin.
Hi, my name is Don Blair, and I'm from Austin. Wait, let me take that back. Let me rephrase this. Hi, my name is Don Blair, and I'm from the Latino community. That's one of the one things we learned. This is one of the biggest things we learned here in NHI, isn't it? That we're a big community. We're not just separate regions, but we're all together. The big question is, what will we be? What will the Latino community be in years to come? Well, here's your answer. We will be a giant community, making more organizations like this. Like, knowing how each other work, how we're a big community, how we're so close together. We will have education that's about our culture very well. We specifically state that most people that don't get know about our culture that much don't know about the injustices. With different organizations like this, we can learn more about our culture, we'll learn more about our different dances and different traditions, and we'll know all about these injustices and stop forgetting about them. We can learn different ways. We'll maybe have not just debate things, but also maybe food and dances and music that we can learn from these kind of things that bring us closer together in organizations like this. We know each other a lot better now, don't we? We can know each other, even if we're not Latino, we're close together, aren't we? We show each other that we're a big community, and we are grateful for that. We can show people that our culture and our traditions are amazing. We can show them that this is very important to us. We can just, all in all, be really great in places like this. More organizations like this will help spread our culture, help spread and teach everybody else. Because if we don't like debate, or if we don't like other stuff like this, such as arguing with each other, we can make more organizations with food. Time? Thank you.
Again, that was Emiliano Pastrano from San Antonio. Or no, sorry, Dominic Blea from Austin. I do apologize. Dominic Blea from Austin. We now welcome speaker number 6, Ms. Tatiana Brown from Dallas. Chris Nieto is acting as your timekeeper, and there are your judges.
Okay, fantastic.
Thank you so much. Wake up, young Latinos. There's an issue we have to address. But first, before I say anything, I need you to imagine something. You are in a pitch black room that seems endless. And there is one door, one, that will let you out. In a realistic sense, young Latinos are in this situation right now. Because what our issue is that everything we're doing is theory. The best way to make a real change is by making sure you're doing something hands-on. In order to do that, we have to free our minds. For example, if we were to travel, we would be going to the places where our issues are current and real. We would meet the people that we're fighting for. I read in Third Reality there was a small story about a man. He had scars all over his face. And someone looked at him and said, "Wow, that must be a bad man." Then he thought about it again and he said, "What if that man was a victim of something bad?" The point of this is that we as people need to see things from a different perspective to understand it better and fight on its behalf. Another thing we need to do is we need to have a community belief. And one thing that I think here at NHR we have to do is we need to make everyone aware of what we are doing. It's crucial that we come in and with social media, with everything crossing the world in a few seconds, we could get so far. Another thing, if you take your free mind and you also take your social media, your awareness, and you send it to different places, your opportunities are knocking on your door. You have things like internships, scholarships, that will just help you jump in the car and get further than where you need to be. If you do everything that I just said, if we free our minds, we travel, meet the people we're fighting for, we come in and we understand the awareness and everything we're doing, and we take up every opportunity that knocks for us, we will be successful. Remember that door I mentioned earlier? If you do everything I just said, you just opened it and walked through it.
Again, judges, that was Tatiana Brown from Dallas. Speaker number seven, Frankie Fregoso from Corpus Christi.
Last day of competition.
Now what?
Where do we go from here?
at the end of the great debate, and we'll ask ourselves, what do we need to do to accomplish those in the future? Right now, as it is, an old statement is coming to mind. You can lead a horse to water, but you can't make it drink. Right now, we're the horses, and the water is our impending future. What do we need to do to go to this impending future? What must we accomplish? In the 15th chapter, of Ernesto Nieto's book, Third Reality, he writes, addressing the issue of Latinos in the United States in the 21st century is ultimately and undoubtedly a priority within the American and Latino American schooling system. What we need to do is reinforce the need for Latino presence in the schooling system. We need to reinforce the idea that Latino students are more than our stereotypes. We have potential. We can free our minds and get out of the boxes that hold us in as stereotypes. We have the ability to accomplish. Now in NHI, this has been a perfect example of being able to accomplish, overcoming stereotypes, realizing our potential, and truly freeing our minds. Now I know that when I return to my hometown, I'll be recruiting the freshman class and helping free their minds, helping them come over here to the great debate and realize and experience what we've gone through. Meeting new people, sharing ideas and values, experiencing victory, loss, but ultimately becoming the Latinos that we need to be. I hope that one day, the incoming classes will free the minds just as I have and just as everyone else here has. Muchas gracias.
That was Frankie Fragoso from Corpus Christi. Now we welcome speaker number 8, Finn Slavin from El Paso. Mr. Nieto is acting as your timekeeper, and these are your judges.
I would like the audience to take a second and picture themselves buying a tree. That's right, a tree. But this is really only about a tree. This tree represents the Latino community. Now, what would you rather buy? A young tree in which you can develop and build into community that is your backyard? Or an older, less adaptable tree that has already instilled its roots into the soil and foundation in which it has its ideals? Obviously the one that is of younger youth that you can develop, correct? Well, as of today, NHI is solely focusing on the older tree, rather those in the high school community. And by doing so, they are really forming a way for the true development. And the true development is within those in the developmental prime, the younger generations. Now, on to the direct answer for which I am trying to make my statement. Through developing the younger generations, you're exposing them to the roots of NHI and therefore exposing them to critical thinking and analysis of communities, which they then have time to develop over time. And with this development comes self-actualization, and within themselves they are able to think more clearly and stay within their own mindset, and in turn, freeing their mind, having a free young youthful mind. And with these intellectuals and a free young youthful mind, they are able to give rise to the community and create new careers based off of what they can bring from themselves. And then this in turn goes back into the ladder, and finally they're able to create a developed path for which they can pursue what they want. Not only in leadership, but in science and technology and love and whatever they wish to pursue within NHI. I would like to conclude this by stating I agree with Ernesto Nieto's final chapter in the Third Reality, which states that education is a key factor in the development of youth. Without the development of youth, we have nothing. We are incapable of any such development whatsoever. Now,
I would like to leave you with this. You train an old dog or teach an old dog new tricks, rather a young dog new tricks. Thank you.
One last time.
This concludes the 2015 Texas Great Debate Finals. The debate aspect of this program is officially finished. Let's give our finalists one more big round of applause. At this time, what we're going to do is we're going to dismiss to dinner. Let me give you some logistics for the evening. We're asking that dinner at 5 o'clock, that we return over here at 7:30 p.m. We're going to have a brief presentation about the next step in your NHI journey, and that includes going back to your regions to recruit new students and to train, but also moving on to the LDZ. We'll talk a little bit more about Celebración. From there, we'll move directly open to the award ceremony, which will begin at 8 p.m., followed by our dance at 9, curfew this evening at 12:30, lights out by 1 a.m. Tomorrow morning, we will have breakfast. Breakfast will be served from 8 to 9. For those regions leaving early, your checkout will be from 7 to 8. Breakfast from 8 to 9. The closing ceremony, which will take place here from 9 until 10. And then actual team checkout between 10 and 11. So now we are going to dismiss to dinner. We'll reconvene at 7:30 p.m. for the presentation on the LDZ and our award ceremony. Thank you, and we'll see you at 7:30.